Opinions about Gilles Deray among modern historians are not just different, they are diametrically opposite. Even if there had been nothing else unusual about the Breton nobleman Gilles Deray 1304-1340, his outstanding career as a soldier in the Hundred Years' War and as a comrade in arms of Joan d'Arc would have been enough to guarantee his place in history. Today, though, those achievements can only be seen in the shadow of the secret life he led as a perpetrator of more than 100 gruesome child murders, a rampage that made him arguably the first serial killer in the recorded history. The life of Deray can be divided into parts, light and full and dark. The early life of Gilles Deray was marked by tragedy. Both his parents died about 1415. His father, Guy de Laval, was killed in a gruesome hunting accident that Deray may have witnessed, and his mother, Marie de Crayon, died on an unknown cause. He was raised by his maternal grandfather, Jean de Crayon. Crayon was a schemer who attempted to arrange a marriage on 12-year-old Gilles to the 4-year-old Jean Parnell, one of the richest heiress of Normandy. When the plan failed, attempted unsuccessful to the knight of a boy Beatrice de Rohan, the niece to the Duke of Brittany. On November 30 of 1420, Crayon substantially increased his grandson's fortune by marrying her to Catherine de Thouars of Brittany, heiress of La Vendée and Poitou. Their only child Marie was born in 1429. As a young man, Deray seems to have been impetuous and hot-headed, characteristic that translated to well battlefield, where he was all accounts a skilled and fearless fighter. In the decades following the Breton War of Succession, the defeated faction led by Oliver de Blois, Count of Penthievre, continued to plot against the Dukes of House on Montfort. The Blois faction, which refused to relinquish its claim to rule over the Duchy of Brittany, had taken Duke John VI prisoner in violation of Treaty of Gerone. The 16-year-old Gilles took the side of House on Montfort. He was able to secure the Duke's release and was rewarded with generous land grants that were converted to monetary gifts. In 1425, Ray was introduced to the court of Charles VII at Saumur, and learned county manners by studying the Dauphin. At the battles of Chateau de Lude, he took prisoner the English Captain Blackburn. From 1427 to 1435, Ray served as a commander in the Royal Army, distinguishing himself for bravery on the battlefield during the renewal of the Hundred Years' War. When Joan of Arc appeared on the scene in 1429, he was assigned by the Dauphin, later Charles VII, to watch over her in battle, so he fought alongside her in some of the campaigns waged against the English and their Burgundian allies. On July 17, 1429, Ray was on the four lords chosen for the honor of bringing the Holy Ampulla from the Abbey of Saint-Rémy to Notre-Dame-de-Reims for the consecration of Charles VII as a King of France. On the same day, he was officially created a Marshal of France. Following the siege of the Orleans, Ray was granted the right to add the border of the royal arms, the fleur-de-lis, on the azure ground to his own. The letters patent authorizing the display cited his high and commendable services, the great perils and dangers he had confronted, and many other brave feats. She was not with Joan when she was burned at stakes, as he was far from her when she was captured. And there is rumors he tried his best to save her. He fought his way to Rouen, but was too late. After her death, he spent a lot of money to honor her, ordered, for example, Mystery de Siege de Rouen, and several years financed the theatrical performance. His military career began to wind down afterwards, and he spent more time on his estate, which was among the richest in western France. Deray spent his fortune recklessly, paying enormous sums for decoration, servants and a large military retinue, and commissioning music and work of literature. He sailed off family lands to finance his extravagant lifestyle sparked a bitter fight with other members of his family, especially Jean de Croyon, who pointedly left his sword and armor to Gilles, the youngest brother Rennes, when he died in 1332. In later years, de Retz seems to have been increasingly concerned with religion and his own salvation. In 1333, he financed the construction of a chapel for the bliss of his soul, which he called the Chapel of Holy Innocence, and which was stuffed, horrifyingly in the lights of de Retz's crime, with a boy's chores selected by de Retz himself. He also investigated the occult as a means to save his rapidly collapsing finances, employing a succession of alchemists and sorcerers. Meanwhile, rumors had begun to circulate. Children had gone missing in the area around de Retz's castle, and many of the disappearances seems to connected to the activities of de Retz and his servants. Because it was common for the young boys to be permanently separated from their parents if they had been taken by the nobles as servants or pars, some of the victims' parents would have been truly unaware of their children's fates. In other areas, though, the Retz murderers' predilections may have become something of an open secret. It came out during his trial, for instance, that witnesses have seen his servants disposing of the bodies of dozens of children at one of his castles in 1337, but the families of the victims were restrained by fear and low social status from taking actions against him. The church had to intervene, but it was uneasy as he was a high noble. De Retz gave the reason to arrest him himself. He beat the clergyman with whom he had a conflict. Remember the Knight's Rules? Bishop of Nantes used this as an opportunity to bring him to the court. De Retz voluntarily came to the trial and accepted the punishment, and it was only a fine. And here was a trap of Bishop. By the law, Marshal of France was to be judged by Crown Court. By accepting the trial and punishment of Bishop of Nantes, he acknowledged the jurisdiction of that court. And immediately he was charged in the range of offenses including heresy, sodomy, and the murder of more than 100 children. Under the threat of torture, de Retz confessed to the charges and described ritualistically torturing dozens of children kidnapped by his servants over a period lasting nearly a decade. He was sentenced to death by simultaneous burning and hanging, and the punishment was carried out in Nantes on October 26, 1340. De Retz had been contrite and composed in the face of execution. This bizarrely brought him posthumous acclaim as a model of Christian penitence. A 3-day fast was even observed after his death. In one last nauseous irony, a tradition emerged in which parents around Nantes commemorated the anniversary of de Retz's execution by wiping their children, perhaps to impress upon them the gravity of the sins for which he had repented. This practice is believed to have survived for more than a century after his death. In modern times, revisionists have questions whether or not de Retz was truly guilty of the crimes for which he has been executed, noting that his confession was extracted using the threat of torture. Most historians who have examined the evidence from de Retz's trial, though, continue to believe that he did in fact commit the murders. Well, that's it for today. Thank you very much for listening. Like it if you do, subscribe if you don't want to miss more. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.